everyone. Today we're going to learn how to trace a simple code made up of some functions and uses recursion. So this is a typical problem that we have to learn how to trace. It's not that difficult, but it's important to understand the concepts of the call stack of functions. A call stack is when a function sits on a call stack and then they go through the sequence. We're gonna go over that. We're gonna look at how we can trace some of these call stacks using a recursive function. So you have the code with you. There's about 29 lines of code traced here. The first line is the include stdio.h. That's for printing, so there's nothing to do there. So before I do any trace, I always examine the code and look for the components and the structure of the code, looking for any obvious errors, any problems before I start. So when I examine this code, I look at this next line, line 2. I notice that there's a global variable, a, and it's initialized to 3. Then I look at that there's a function f and a function g. So f takes one parameter. Note that the function f calls g. And g takes two parameters, and note that the function g calls the functions r and h. This is just through observations when you're kind of skimming through this code. And you look at function h, it seems to be a simple function there. And then there's a function r. And from what I can tell, r looks like a recursive function, and I can tell that because look at the line 18, return r a minus 1. So basically, the function r on line 15 has a call to itself on line 18, which makes it recursive. Now, hopefully, we have the right base case in that. Now, it helps if you kind of can tell what this function does. If you can't, that's OK. We're going to trace it. But if you can, if you know what this function does, for example, does it calculate a summation? Does it calculate anything simple recursively? Then we can just go ahead and use it so we don't have to trace all the function calls. But for the purpose of this exercise, I'm going to trace the whole call. So you can see how a function is traced in the call stack. Then comes main. And in main, there's a bunch of print statements, which basically force me to call the different functions. And there's a return, and that ends it. So far, it looks good. The only observation I have is that the function f, g, and h do not, and r, do not have prototypes. Now, technically, you should always have prototypes. But for the purpose of this trace, since the functions were provided before main and before they are called, as long as the function appears before it's called, that would be OK with the compiler, and we can get away with it. So technically, this program would work, from what I can tell, without really digging deep into it. But that's the first exercise that you do. So let's recap. If I want to start tracing this one, I would look at the first piece, and there's int a equal to 3. That's line 2. So that a is actually a global variable, and it sits out there, and it has a value of 3. So what I show, I always try to show the storage of these variables and the scope. Okay, and any call stacks. And I'll show you how I'm going to explain the call stack. So there's nothing to do in f, g, h, r. We start now in main. So now, after I declare the global variable, I am in the function main. So if anybody asks, we are inside the function main. Are there any variables declared inside main? Nope, not that I can see. There are no variables declared inside the function main. Okay, so main sits on the call stack. What I'm going to do, usually the call stack is an upside down call stack, but here I'm going to go top to bottom. So we're going to start from the top, and whenever a function is called, it goes below the main, and then when we get out of this function, we return back. So it's a reverse, if you want to say, like an upside down call stack. All right, so let's take a look. Here, the first line says print. Oh, so we need to have output. So I'm going to go on this side of the screen, and I'm going to show my output very clearly. So I'm going to write output. And you always have to be careful to make sure that you show exactly what it's going to appear in the console or on the screen when you execute this program. So if there's a space, if there's a tab, show it. Make sure you have enough space. So for what I can tell, you have to print %d, which is a, backslash t, and backslash t meaning it's a tab. OK, so it looks like I'm going to print a. So I'm in main, and I'm looking for a. And the rule says, search the current scope, and you don't find it here. That means you go out, and there it is. It's in the global scope. So I'm referring to the global a, which is 3. So the output of my first statement is 3 tab. So I'm going to use this symbol. I can note it here on the side that this is a tab. That's my tab symbol. All right, next line. Print %d, so again, we're looking for a number, backslash t, a tab, and it's going to be the call of f of a. So we know that we're going to call a function f, and this function is going to sit on the call stack. So main calls f. That's why it's just after main. So look at the function f in line 3. F is a function that declares a local parameters, which is a local variable, a, and the value of this parameter is a from main. So when I was in main, what was a? There is no a here, so it's a global, it's 3. So f of a is really f of 3. So that means the value of this parameter is 3. Okay, so now we can go ahead and execute the function f. So let's take a look. In line 5, it says return g a plus 1 comma a minus 1. So this simply means f calls g. So g is going to sit on the call stack. So now I'm going to execute g. G is a function that takes two parameters, a and b. Remember that the parameters are local variables. So the value of the first parameter, now I go back to the line on line 5, in f, the value of the first parameter is a plus 1. So in f, a is 3. A plus 1, 3 plus 1 is 4, and that's the first parameter. The value of the second parameter is a minus 1. So 3 minus 1 is 2. So the value of b will be 2. So now I can execute the function g with a is being 4 and b being 2. So now we look at the body of g, line 9. So in this line, we're going to call the function r, then plus b plus h. Ooh, I got to call two functions. So let's go left to right because the addition is done left to right. So we can call the function r, and r is going to sit on the call stack. R is a function that takes a parameter called a. Now, don't be confused by the fact that there's many variables called a. You see, this a lives in r, this a lives in g, this a lives in f, this a up here is a global one. So as long as you have the same variable but in different scopes, it's not really the same variable, okay, the same variable name. That's okay. What I cannot have is I cannot have two variables of the same name in the same scope. So those are different scopes. Think of them as different rooms. So it doesn't matter as long as you have only one in each room. Okay, so let's take a look. So now we're running the function r and with the parameter a. So here I take a look, and what is the value of the parameter a? So it's being called from line 9. In line 9, that's function g. So I'm in g. I'm looking at a minus 1, so r of a minus 1. So a is 4. What is 4 minus 1? Now remember, 4 minus 1 doesn't change a. A minus 1 doesn't affect a. It's just the response of this is passed. So a minus 1 is 3. 4 minus 1 is 3. So we're going to call r of 3. So that parameter is going to have the value of 3. Okay, so now we set up r. We're going to execute it. So as I said, this is a recursive function. So it looks to me that if a is less than or equal to 1, that should be the base case, return 1. Otherwise, you return r of a minus 1 plus a. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to use a slightly different color to show these recursive calls. So now, is a is less than or equal to 1? Now, a is 3 because I'm in r. No, it's not. So what are we going to do? We're going to call r of a minus 1. So there's r is going to sit on the call stack. R is a function that takes a parameter a, and the value of a is going to be 3 minus 1, which is 2. So now we're going to run this whole thing over, start the function back on line 15. We enter it with a value of 2. We're going to run line 17 again. Is a, which is 2, less than or equal to 1? No, it's not. So return r of a minus 1. So there's r again. There's another call stack. R is a function that takes a parameter called a, and the value of a is 2 minus 1, which is 1. All right, now we start all over again. So it says, line 17, is a less than or equal to 1? Let me see. Is a equal to 1? Yes. Return 1. So this function returns 1. So now we're going to pop this off the call stack, and we're going to go back to the previous call. This is why lining up these functions is so critical, so that you can maintain this call stack, the sequence of calls, if you wish. So where do I go from here? This function terminates with 1. I go back to this function, the one right above it, exactly where I left off. And this is line 18. So r of a minus 1 turned out to be 1. So let's proceed. What's 1 plus a? Well, a is 2 in here. See? So 1 plus 2 is 3. Return that. So that's going to return 3. Where do I go back? Exactly to the previous function, line 18, where I left off. So r of a minus 1, or 3 minus 1, was 3. Okay? So 3 plus a, which is 3, is 6. So we're going to return 6. Where do I go back to? I go back to g. So g, remember line 9, return r of a minus 1? Well, that's 6. Okay, so what about it? 6 plus b, well, b is 2. So that's 8 so far, plus h of a. Ooh, I got to figure out what h of a is. Okay, so I'm going to start over here, another stack. So I'm going to call the function, ooh, let's go back to yellow. I'm going to call the function, which one was it? H. So h is a function that's going to sit on the call stack. And h is has a parameter called c, which is a local variable. And the value of that parameter is a from line 9 from g. So here's g. What's a? A is 4. So guess what? 4 is copied here. It's passed by value. So c is going to be 4. So h of 4, or h with c is 4. We're ready to run h. So now we're looking at line 13, which basically says return a is equal. Okay, you see, when you got this expression, a plus equals c times 2, that really means a is equal to a plus c times 2. So I have to do the multiplication first, c times 2. So I'm here, c is 4. 4 times 2 is 8. So a, where is a? There's no a in h. So what's the rule of resolving the scope? You search the current scope. If you find it, you use it. If you don't find this variable, you go out of the scope. And when I go out, I don't go back in anywhere. I just go out and look for it out here. And there it is. It's in global, right there. There's A. So I'm really referring to this A. So let's run this line again. So this A is going to be equal to itself, 3, plus C times 2. 4 times 2, 8. So 8 plus the 3. And that is going to be overwritten here. Makes sense? 4 times 2, 8, 9, 10, 11. 11. It's going to live here. So now a in the global is 11. So when I leave this function here, we're going to return that value of a. Not only that you set it, but you also return it. So this is going to exit. And it's going to return 11. So it changed a, the global variable, but also it returned, because it says return a plus whatever. So it's going to return the value of a after you have changed it. OK, so where do I go back to? Looking at my call stack, oh, I'm back in g. So let's do g again. So now h of a turns out to be 11. All right, so let's see. R of a minus 1 was 6. OK, so I've got 6 plus b. B is 2, so 7, 8, plus the 11. B of h of a. So 6, 7, 8, plus the 11. So 8 plus 11 is 19. So what are we going to do with this? We're going to return 19. OK. So where do we go from here? We go back to f. We just follow. You know, that's why the call stack is important, to keep this order. So it's very easy. If you lose your spot, if you kind of mind drift somewhere, you go somewhere and try to say, oh, where's my spot? I lost my spot. You're looking here at the call stack. You say, well, no, I'm actually in F, and I just finished calling G. So I look at F, and that's, look, line 5 in F. So G turns out to be 19. It says return that. So that's going to return 19. And I'm back to main. Ta-da. So in main, line 23, that's where I called F. So guess what? We're going to print F, which is 19, tab. 19, tab. Maybe I should make it a little bit bigger, but I'm running out of space on that board. So let's see. Now the third line of main, line 24, and basically says print a number, new line, and h of a. OK, so we're going to call h. H is a nice, lovely function that has a local variable or parameter called c. And the value of that parameter c is going to be a. And I'm in main. I'm looking for a. I don't see an a here, so it's got to be the global. Oh, look, it's 11. See, that's very important to make that change. So that's 11. So what is h of 11? OK, well, let's do this. So this function h is line 13. says return, so that's A plus equal C times 2, right? That's the line there. So basically, C is 11 times 2, that's going to be 22. And then A is equal to A plus C times 2, so this part is 22. What is A? I'm in H, I'm looking for A. There's no A here, you got to go out, there's a global, it's 11. So we're going to do 11 plus the 22, okay? So that's going to be 33, and that is going to be copied back to A, which is the global one. So this one is going to be 33. So after I assign it, I'm done that, now I'm going to return it. So it's going to return 33. Where do I go back to? Looking at my call stack, I'm back to main. Okay, so I'm back in main. This is where I printed H of A, so I'm going to print 33, new line. 33, new line. So I'm going to put like a little dot here, just to remind me that's my next spot. Just as a little pointer there to remind me where my next output will be. It's not on the same line to enter a new line. So I'm back in main, line 25, A minus minus. So again, I'm in main, I'm looking for A, no A, go out. Oh, 33, so 33, A minus minus is going to be 32. Extend this a bit. So now I'm looking at A where it's 32. Okay, so far so good. Let's print, oh dear, F of A divided by 10. Okay, so there's a number, a tab, and then we have to call the function F. All right, let's go for it. Ready? So we're going to continue our calls, so we're going to call the function f. Now you got a little bit more experience with it. F is a function that takes a parameter a, and the value of that parameter, I'm in main, I'm looking for a, there's no a, it's 32, it's a global. So what is f of, oh, I made a mistake, it's actually a over 10. So what is 32 divided by 10? Now you got to be careful here, because f takes a parameter which is an integer. And 32 divided by 10 is 3.2, mathematically, but it's an integer. So it can never be that 2. So it's just a 3, because you drop the decimal. So f of 3. So in this case, you got to realize that 32 divided by 10 is just 3 integer. When you pass it to f, you're only capturing the integer. It might give you a warning on that in some compilers, depending on the warning level, because you're going from a double 3.2 to an integer, and you're dropping. There's a loss in data. So there could be an issue there. I may want to make a little comment there next to the code so that I can say, watch out here. You may have to do an explicit cast on this. So basically, accept the conversion from a double to an integer and the loss of the 0.2. Otherwise, we can proceed. So what is f of 3? All right, well, hey, didn't I do that before? Well, we can go that route, but that's dangerous because the global value changed, so I actually have to trace this. So let's go ahead and do it. It's not going to be so bad. We're going to call the function, so I'm looking at line 5 here in F, so that's going to call the function G. So G is going to sit on the call stack. G is a function that takes two parameters, A and B, and the value of the first parameter, notice how I say the first parameter and second parameter, and I don't say A and B because it gets confusing. So the first parameter, that's on the left side of line 5, so A plus 1. So I'm in F, A is 3, 3 plus 1 is 4. I'm in F, A is 3, 3 minus 1 is 2. See, the first parameter is 4, the second parameter is 2. It happens to be A and B, big deal. So now I'm inside G, and I'm ready to execute G. So G says, call the function R. R is going to sit on this call stack. And R is a happy function that has a local parameter called A. And the value of A is going to be, in G, we're looking at R of A minus 1. So in G, I'm looking for A. Here it is. It's 4. What's 4 minus 1? It's 3. So we're going to call this R with the value of 3. Now, let's execute this. Again, we can take some shortcuts, but I'm going to just go through the full trace. So I ask, I'm inside line 17 now. Is 3 less than or equal to 1? Nope, it's not. So we're going to call the function R of A minus 1. So again, R is a function that has a parameter A, and A minus 1 is going to be 2. So we're going to restart this function call. So we're back to line 17. Is A, which is 2, less than or equal to 1? No, it's not. So then we go to line 18 and return R of A minus 1. So now we enter a different function, and this one is going to be 1. So we enter line 17 again. is a, which is 1 in this case, less than or equal to 1? Well, it is. So return 1. And then I go back to this function. So now r of a minus 1 is 1. So what is r of a minus 1 plus a? So what is 1 plus a? It's 1 plus 2. Well, that's 3. So we're going to return that. Then I go back here. What's 3 plus 3? R of a minus 1 plus a. So that's 6. Well, yeah, it is the same there. Well, that's good news. You know, we did something, right? It is consistent. So this is going to go back to G. So in G, let's go back to line 9. So r of a minus 1 times turns out to be 6. So what is h of a? H of a, well, I guess I have to call it. So let's call the function h. And the function h has a local parameter called c. And the value of that parameter is going to be a from g. So a in g is 4. So that parameter is going to be 4. So let's resolve it, just like we did above here, the calculation. So we're going to return a plus equals c times 2. So c times 2 is 8. And a, what is a? There's no a in h. You got to go back here. And this time, a is 32. All right, so let's try again. So we've got the 32, OK? So a is going to be equal to 32 plus, let's see. So a plus equals c times 2. So c times 2, it's 4 times 2. So that's going to be 8. 32 plus the 8, it's going to be the 40. So we're going to assign this to a. So I have to overwrite a. It's going to be 40. And then, let's not confuse that. So we also return a, which is 40. That's a bit tricky. You got to remember to modify the global, but you just follow the steps. All right, great. So h turns out to be 40. So going back, where do I go back from here? I'm going back to g. See, it's easy to find my spot here. So going back to g, line 9. So let's recap. R of a minus 1 turns out to be 6. So I've got, here, let's write it here, 6 plus b, b is 2, plus the h of a, which turns out to be 40. That's our d sub, so you got 48. So what do I do with this? Well, you're going to return this. So g is going to return 48, and I go back to f. So I'll come back to f. All right, so let's see. Return g of a plus 1, a minus 1. So guess what? You're just going to return the 48. That's the result of the function g. So where do I go back to? Well, all the way back to main. So I'm back on line 26, and the output of line 26 is actually 48 tab. Oh, good thing I had the dot there. I can take it out now. Thank you. 48 tab. All right. So now we're on the next line, 27, print a. So I'm in main, very important, I'm in main, I'm looking for A. No A, out of the global, oh, look, it's 40. Okay, that was line 27. Anything else? Nope, for line 28, return A, so I'm in main, I'm returning, A is 40, out I go. So it doesn't matter, some people get confused about this. Oh, you're returning A, you're returning 40, why are you not returning 0? There is no big deal. It's not going to affect the output. But you got to understand, this return is used in script programming when one program calls another. And the standard is when you return 0, which is what we usually do, it really implies to the caller, whoever called this program, that when I get back a 0, it's a normal termination. It's a normal execution. The program ran correctly and ended peacefully and returned a 0. If it doesn't return a 0, then we can make up some error codes. Like if you return minus 1, it means one thing, minus 2, well, we couldn't open a file, minus 3, we couldn't get input, so whatever you want it to be. So we can communicate by means of these numbers. So I just wanted to show you in this example that it doesn't have to be 0. And don't get confused if main happened to return some number other than 0. It doesn't affect the output and shouldn't confuse you. OK, so now that I'm done main, my call stack is empty. You see, main was the first on the call stack. First in was the last one out. That's a first in, last out. That's what the call stack is. So once I terminate the program, all this is gone. Everything I crossed is gone. And this is my output. So I can double check, and I look at my main. There's a number, a tab, a number, a tab, a number, a new line. And finally, a number. Yep, it looks right. OK, so Thank you for watching this video, and you should practice yourself. And what you can do is you can change some of these values, change A from 3 to say 2, change some numbers here and there. You can always compile it. You can use the CC command to compile it and look at the output and compare your work. What's very important is that you show your call stack and your variable values as they change over time, clearly showing the global and the local variables. Thank you.